today we're really fortunate. We've got a person here to tell us about his piece of the air war over North Vietnam, flying the F-105. Gordy Jenkins was a Cajun Kunas from Louisiana, and he graduated from, what was the name of that place? Baton Rouge High School in 1960 or so. Went on to LSU. They finally threw him out of there in January 65. He went on to pilot training, and he was part of a unique group. Gordy was one of eight pilot training graduates that were sent straight to the THUD, straight to the F-105. In the early days, they used to, you know, build up their experience somewhere else, throw you in this world's largest single-engine jet fighter and throw you into combat. Well, Gordy was one of those eight, that half of them made it back, and he'll tell us part of that story today. Gordy also was probably one of the most highly decorated lieutenants flying the air war. Two Silver Stars, three DFCs, 15 air medals, and a partridge in a pear tree. Anyway, on with that, Gordy's going to tell us about what he was doing flying the THUD over in Vietnam. He also did two tours. He went back to the F-4 in Korat, as you said. But he's going to tell us about his experiences in the THUD. F-105, great story. And there's, Kelly, do we have any Kleenex? Gordy gets a little emotional, so if you don't have Kleenex, there's some napkins in the back if you need them for your tears. Gordy, you're on.
Bob, it's really an honor to be here with you. I'm leaving because I just had to kill this surgery a couple of months ago. Everyone here has a story similar to the one I'm going to tell you. And I would encourage you to do what I did about 4 years ago. I realized there was nobody telling the 105 story. And so I got a hold of my buddies, and probably this number, maybe a little larger, 1,500 mission guys. Is this loud enough for you guys in the back? Can you hear me?
No.
A little louder.
Okay. But anyway, I got a hold of some of my friends who also had flown 105s, and we sent photos back and forth and stories back and forth, and so I created this thing about 3 years ago. I did it maybe a dozen times around the country, and I get great enjoyment from it because if I, for example, don't tell the 105 story, nobody else is. But you were all sitting there with that revenue in your head of what you did and what you did. And I ask you just to go out to your buddies, collect some video or some films, and PowerPoint things, put it together into a presentation, and you can do it too so that your history is not lost. Okay? I would hope you would do that. This, someone here came up with the title Risky Business. I'll let you decide. I dedicate this to our two 105 Medal of Honor winners, not winners, I apologize, awardees. You don't win the Medal of Honor, you are awarded the Medal of Honor for your state. Please go on the internet and look up Merle Bentheson, the guy on the left, and Leo Thorsens, the guy on the right. I was honored to be in the squadron with Leo. He was 2 doors down from me in the hooch, and he spent 7 years as a POW. He just passed away last year. Merle made it through the mid-90s, and he passed away, so we don't have any 105 Medal of Honor awardees left. Rolling Thunder, you know, we hear about that. The guys who were there, in retrospect, now we look back on it, and we realize it was given a name for that period so that LBJ could take the targets in North Vietnam. It was so political, and I'll show you a slide later talking about how he did that. It wasn't by name places, it was in rings of Hanoi and Haiphong. So it was a totally political thing, no clearly defined message. There was no definition of wanting to win the war. It was just, we're going to go and bomb people. White House picked everything they would call JCS targets. They weren't called White House targets. 300,000 sorties, and more flown by the 105 and more losses by the 105 than any other aircraft during this period. Here was the goal of did I go through something? No. Here's the goal of everybody over there, the patch and the coin. And I thought I'd brought a coin with me, I could pass around, but I'm getting older and I must have left it on the counter. But the Air Force made us stop wearing that patch in the mid-70s because there were a few of us that We made this coin about 5 years ago, and we show it around at the reunions. Here were my eight lieutenants that we went through pilot training together. Everybody up there was number one in his class, and we all ended up at Dallas for a six-month checkout. Of that group of eight, five got through, and it's interesting. We showed up at Top Lee, and they took the eight of us into base operations, waiting for the squadrons to come pick us, to send us the eight to three squadrons. And we were standing there looking at the wall, and they had these plywood boards, nothing as fine as this. And one was labeled 100 Missions over North Vietnam. The other was labeled POWMIAKIA. And they both had the same number of little name tag. And we looked around and we said, this is a 50-50 deal. And it was. We lucked out. We got eight of our guys, or five of us, eight got through and completed. Jim Shiley on the top left there was my roommate. And the hardest thing I ever had to do was to write a letter to his mother the day after he got shot down. He was shot down on his 50th mission. And we had all made it through 50, and at the end, we lost two other guys. But he spent 7 years in Hanoi, and the last time I saw him, he showed up when I came back from Korat, and by the way, F-4s and 105 Weasels. But when I came back from Korat on my second tour, he was waiting in San Antonio when I got off the airplane. Here's, you've seen this map a million times, but it describes the basic area we were in. And I'll talk more about this later, but here's the route that they would take, Ho Chi Minh Trail, through Laos and then Cambodia to get to where they wanted to go. And of course our politician says, we can't go there. We're not at war with them. We might make the Russians mad at us. Well, you can carry that over to World War II. That means we couldn't have attacked Normandy because we weren't at war with the French. We could only attack Germany. Well, this is a bunch of crap, pardon my French. So here is how we broke the country up into what we call route packages. 1, 2, 3, and 4 were primarily Navy, although the Air Force got a few of these because they sent us up on easy missions. We call these single pumpers down in 1, 2, and 3 because there weren't as many guns in that area as up around Hanoi. You can't quite see it, but here's San Tay prison camp. I'll tell you a little about that. Here's Hanoi. Here's the Paul Wilmer Bridge. Fukien, one of the airports, airfields that you had big out of, and here's Kep. There's the infamous Spud Ridge that we'd hide behind, and here's Thailand. San Tay was a blessing. You remember, we tried to get the guys out of there, and they were there 2 weeks before we arrived with all those helicopters. But they had a bad water in the camp. The guards couldn't survive on the water, much less the POWs. So they packed everybody up, took them to Hanoi. And everybody in that group said the San Tay raid forced the North Vietnamese to bring the prisoners from all these small camps into Hanoi. And so they saw each other for the first time. And it was a big morale boost for San Tay, even though the mission didn't work. Now here is the crap that we went through. Can you imagine, extrapolate this to Germany. Here's Hanoi. We had a 10-mile prohibited zone. You couldn't fly over it. We had a 30-mile restricted zone that only you could fly into there only if the targets were approved by the JCS, which is the White House. And the same two circles around Haiphong. Haiphong was a major port. As long as they had that port, they could bring in big amounts of supplies from Russia and China, and a lot of stamps. So these circles meant that the targets that the Air Force was allowed to pick were in this white area. Can you imagine World War II if we couldn't have bombed Berlin because there might have been some Russians there? But that's the mindset that LBJ had. He controlled the targets using these little circles to tell us when we could go inside the hash line here. We never got in here during our time until Nixon took over later. And I'll tell you about that in one of the last slides. So anyway, that's the kind of stuff we went through. And you will hear on the Ken Burns series that air power but never won a war. Well, I'm going to tell you something later that kind of made me take your breath away a little bit. Here to Scotland in 65, we didn't have revetments. We just had, there was some silver 105s still there at the time, but they got painted all the time over time. The kids on the flight line, God bless them, they were able to do an engine change in 8 hours. 8 hours. Take the S section off, pull the motor out, put a new motor in, bolt it back up, and off you go. And the engine changed from a 400 hour to a 200 hour requirement because we were all running around afterburner flying these missions, which the airplane, you know, the older engine change regime that they set up based on mid power ranges. So these kids stay up all night and go to work the next day. Korat was the other 105 base. I was there on my second tour in the Weasels and began to, you can see the silver airplanes here. This was a 64, 65 shot. They were on everything that I had drag. Here's one of the six squadrons. We had three squadrons at each base. And you can see this is the 13th. There's one of my buddies, Mac Angel, right there. He's a Thunderbird. You hear a lot about names of airplanes. And World War II, an airplane was mentioned. Vietnam, we had our names on airplanes, our whatever we wanted to call them, airplane. Of course, that changed. As soon as I left or somebody got shot down, scrape off the old name, put the new name on. So the names were constantly changing. It wasn't like the name is always tied to the airplane, other than your mind if you were there. Bob and Buzzy, my good buddy Buzzy, are going to be at that thing on the 12th in our party suits. This started up with an organization called the Red River Valley Fighter Pilots Association. And so we'd all get drunk and pull each other's patches off, but it was a lot of fun. Good bunch of guys. Roscoe, there's a story about a pilot who brought this dog in on a C-130, and then he got shot down. So the dog became everybody's dog. And he would sit in the wing commander's chair during the briefings. And the story was that his ears twitched, it was going to be a hard mission. But if he's sleeping, it was going to be an easy one. But Roscoe was a sweet, sweet dog. I remember sitting at the dining room table and handing him scripts. And he'd just sit there, talk to Bill Buck, and everybody fed him. He probably died of cholesterol. But he's got you can see his headstone there. Right outside the Korat Officers Club is this headstone. That guy on the left is J.J. Smith. He retires as a tech sergeant. He and I were together at five different places in the F-105. Nellis, Tom Lee, Nellis, Korat, and finally George. Every time I show up at a base, there's J.J. And he spent his life working on 105s. He was known as the guy who could diagnose a problem and fix it like that. And in Vietnam, the requirement was on the airplanes with all that high power that you add oil to the fill line on the motor after every flight. JJ didn't do that. Every time his airplane flew, he drained the entire oil system out, put in fresh oil. He just loved the airplane and the people flew it. You can't see this very well. It's pretty dim. But if you can, I'll read off some of the prices here. Okay, French fried potatoes were 15 cents. Chili was 25 cents. Golden shrimp, $1. Of course, you know, that may sound like a lot of money, but we were getting paid $2 a day combat pay tax-free. So we were wealthy. Here's one of our monks to Uncle Ho, one of you guys, that the crew chiefs that maybe they did it on their own. Thank Merry Christmas, Uncle Ho. And this was some guy's 100th mission, so he had the number 100 painted on that bomb. We went for 100 missions. That was the rule when I was there. Later on, when things settled down a little bit, they changed it to a year. But I was there 7 months and one day. Here's the largest piece of ordnance we had. It's a 3,000 pounder. And you can see the tire here is kind of stressed. I think they needed to pump it up a little bit. But that was the biggest load we carried. We had one of these under each wing. And the secret was you had to hold the pickle button down for a couple of seconds to get the signals to go fire. And I didn't do that one mission up in, around Hanoi. And when I started pulling out, I realized I had one heavy wing and the airplane's going like this. So I had to dump everything off, but you know, the little secrets of how to do things, you learn real quickly when you do the wrong thing. Here's the weasel ordinance. I went up as a second tour as a weasel, and then they ended the war on me. I didn't get any combat time as a weasel. But you can see here the two missiles Standard arm is a great big limit, Mach 1.8 and 56 mile range. And the Stripe, which was easier to carry, Mach 1.5, 15 mile range. The problem with, kind of the problem with both of these is to shoot, to fire them, you had to kind of get into the lion's den and pet the kitty. You had to go where they were inside their range of fire to do what we had to do with these pieces of work. So the first thing you ever did with a weasel was get rid of this limit. This, it weighed about 2,000 pounds, so you don't want to fly around with a 2,000 pound heavy wing. So that gets fired off at the first signal. And our job as a weasel was simply to go in, attract the kitty, pet the kitty, feed the kitty a little bit of some of these, and then just detract him from going after the attacking force. So we would come in, go in first and come out last. And that's why the weasel didn't have a lot of longevity as far as getting to 100. Here's the gun being reloaded. We had a 20 millimeter Gatling gun in the nose. And you can see the gun here and the intake here. So we couldn't expel the ammunition, the spent ammunition. It just went into a drum and fell into the center fuselage. It also kept our CG from getting screwed up, because we didn't, if you dumped all that, all those rounds, you'd have a very light nose airplane. That was about a 10 second firing capability, but it was like the A-10, you know, it was an electrically fired gun. Whole airplane shakes when you do it. The buzzing and Bob know about that. I put this picture of this young fellow. We don't have a real good contrast here, but that kid sitting there at the table, it reminded me, when I was there as a lieutenant at Top Lee, I had about 50 missions with these guys with about 20 missions. One of them came up to me and says, "Gordy, would you mail this letter if I don't make it back someday?" I said, "Sure." So I put it in my desk. Within a week, he was gone. Just the airplane obliterated. I put it in the mail. But it's just my, there were people who go into combat thinking they're going to die, and they're always a little pensive, you could tell. I was just a damn lieutenant. All I owned in the world was a Corvette. And so I didn't have anything to worry about. I didn't have a wife and a house and even a dog at the time. But you can see here the guys coming out of the squadron. You have your parachute, your vest on here, G-suit, and your helmet in your hand. And you wander out to your airplanes and ride a truck out to the airplanes and off you go. Here's a shot of the close-up of the vest. There's a pistol. I always thought if I ever got shot down and they're surrounded by these guys, I'd just do this, because what am I going to do, fight the war by myself? We had a 150-foot line of cable here that you, if you land in a tree, which there mostly are there where we're bombing, you could wrap it around the tree and skin you down on the thing. The biggest, most important thing is we had two UHF radios, so we could talk to the rescue forces if they were around. Cart starts. You can imagine we're sending out 20 airplanes from each squadron in the morning and 20 in the afternoon. And the that would have been a major problem for the cart starts, the, you know, the little machines you drag around like the airlines do to start the motors. We had a big coffee can-like thing that when you hit the button, it would boom, and it was forcing air into the engine turbine section, starting at the motor at 55% to bring the throttle on when the motor starts. But it was a very acrylic smoke, and got your attention. Here's taxiing out to the arming area. You can see that it wasn't a very wide taxiway. It's very close here. And then you get out to the end and they pull the pins out of the ordnance, whatever you had. And this is your favorite guy. I don't care whether you're religious or atheistic. When this guy shows up and gives you the thumbs up, made you feel good. The chaplain comes out and says goodbye. 500 miles north of Hanoi. That's sort of like, if you can picture, you're taking off from Palm Springs and going to Denver every day. And back, hopefully. The airplane was designed for both this, which is a boom receptacle, and the probe and probe also. Here's the artist's depiction. This is a Keith Ferris drawing of the Dormer Bridge being hit by 3,000 pounders that had been dropped off this D-model. And we bombed that bridge, not until August, right after I left, we didn't bomb the bridge. Nor did we bomb the airfields, because there might have been Russians there. Even though they're taking off and trying to kill us, we can't catch them on the ground. I remember one mission, I was rolling in, going downhill, 45 degree dive bomb dance along with everybody else in the flight. And something caught my eye. I looked over, and there's a big 17 like this right there in the flight with us. They would try to distract us so we wouldn't bomb our targets. Interesting. Here's one of those standard army being fired off of a 105. This is, again, an artist's depiction, of course. But you can see he's launching this drill off so that now he doesn't have a 2,000 pound load on that side. This gas tank line now is empty, so he's fairly symmetrical weight wise. Okay, you've heard, maybe you've heard, that there were more enemy air defenses within 60 miles of Hanoi than in the entire European theater of operations. That's Colonel Robin Holmes, who's going to be, is she coming here to speak at this point?
Yep.
But, well, Christina is his daughter. And he was the commander of the 8th Wing at Ulan, which is one of the bases in Thailand with us, applying F-4s. He had 13 kills in Europe and 4 in Vietnam. And one of my buddies got a kill that could have been credited to Oles, but Oles called him when the command hot on, said, I'm glad you got that name, because that would have been my 5th and I'd have to go home. And that's the kind of guy he was. You're not going to be able to get this, so unfortunately I'm going to read it to you, because this is goddamn important. The question, is this a treasonous act? This is from General Piotrowski's book, Basic Airman to General, Secret War and Other Conflicts. And here's the page references. Nearly 20 years later, former Secretary of State Dean Rusk was being interviewed by Peter Arnett on a documentary called 10,000 Day War. Mr. Arnett asked, it has been rumored that the U.S. provided the North Vietnamese government the names of the targets that would be bombed the following day. Is there any truth to this allegation? They're telling the enemy what actual targets were given? Well, they were picking them. To everyone's astonishment and absolute disgust, the former secretary responded, yes, we didn't want to harm the North Vietnamese people, so we passed the targets to the Swiss embassy in Washington with instructions to pass them to the North Vietnamese government through their embassy in Hanoi. So they knew where we're coming. This might have had an impact on why all those 5,000 guns were in the worst place for us every day. As we watched in horror, the secretary went on to say, all we wanted to do is to demonstrate to the North Vietnamese government that we could strike targets at will, but we didn't want to kill innocent people. How nice of us. By giving the North Vietnamese advance warning of the targets to be attacked, we thought they would tell the workers to stay home. No wonder all the targets were so heavily defended day after day. The North Vietnamese obviously moved as many guns as they could overnight to better defend each target. They knew it was going to be attacked. Clearly, many brave American Air Force and Navy flyers died or spent years in North Vietnamese prison camps as a direct result of being intentionally betrayed by Secretary Rusk and Secretary McNamara and perhaps President Johnson himself. I would remove the perhaps. I cannot think of a more duplicitous and treacherous act of American government officials. And Mr. Arnett, opined that this would be a treasonous act by anyone else. Shit. We didn't know this, of course, until Piotrowski's book came out 2 years ago. They had over 5,000 guns of various abilities to hit things, and they had numerous SAMs being brought in through the port at Haiphong from Russia. We had 27 and a half MiG kills because there was some argument between an F-4 gun and a 105 gun and debrief over who got the MiG, so they just gave each one a half. Here's an area that you can see the bomb craters around here. If you look, there's a little town up here. No bomb craters. Here's the town. No bomb craters. Here's a little town. No bomb craters. The craters were on the transportation routes. Here's what we were talking about, the Ho Chi Minh Trail in the 1712. Defies logic that your enemy in a war is going around you through these other countries, and you can't go get them there because we're not at war with those countries. Well, technically, we weren't at war with Vietnam either, I guess. But to think that we put these kind of limits on ourselves and allowed ourselves to be in run in some altruistic, for some altruistic rationale, is nuts. And so we lost a lot of guys, and a lot of guys in this room have buddies who died in this area, a lot was in the academy, right? In that eight, and he and I were the only two who got flight lead status because Bob White from Edwards, who's the X-15 pilot, was our DO, and he flew with our squadron. And he convinced the wing commander that we could have a flight lead. Well, here I am on my first flight lead mission, right up here in a bend just north of the DMZ. And the target is right here. This is what it looks like. Now, there's fools that go take this trip and get helicopters and take pictures so you can find things on the internet that, you know, you'd have to have been there to see and to remember. But they will wait. And so, again, now putting all this together, they were waiting because they knew we were coming. Thank you very much, Dean Russ. We don't want to hurt North Vietnamese people. They're sure trying to hurt us. But anyway, so that was the target area. I rolled in and pulled off. 45-degree dive on the pass, 550 knots pickle, 6 750s on the center line, multiple trip rack. Pulled off and looked back, and there's a new cloud, like one of these circles on this road, right where I had come from. And I looked down, and my wingman was 4 seconds behind me. He's coming up looking like a cigar on fire. Smoke coming off the rear end, he's trying to get off to. I said to myself, shit, my first flight lead, I'm losing my wingman. What kind of deal is this? You know, this can't happen. So he still had a radio on his gym as best he could. And he's coming up this way. There's the ocean. And there's South Vietnam, the DMZ right here. And here's Thailand and Laos over here. So I said, shit, he'll never make it to the ocean. I don't want to go down there where all the bad guys are. So I told him, turn and head west. So he's still turning. He rolls up. Still climbing, the airplane's burning from the rear end like a big cigar. Finally, I said, bail out, and he did. He bailed out about 500 knots, which is quite a shock to the body, you know, unless you're Arnold Schwarzenegger. And so I see the chute, it's a good chute. He goes down, lands on the side of a hill into the trees. The chute's hung up in the trees. So I fixed it on my Doppler, the little system again, so I could put that as my target, as for knowing where to come back to. So I'm circling around, I go on guard channel, and I say, mayday, 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 Barracuda 2 is down. So they come up immediately and start talking to me. I gave them the coordinates, and I said, when will you have some rescue forces? And he said, they're on their way. It might be 20 or 30 minutes. And I looked at my gas gauge, and it was getting low, so I went immediately to a tanker. Somebody here was a tanker pilot.
Here.
God bless you, because if he hadn't been there, I couldn't have done what I did later. Anyway, within 5 minutes, I was hanging on this tanker getting the top off, and then back to the area. I get back to the spot, and I can still see the chute hanging in the tree, and I went back on guard, and I said, what's the status of the rescue forces? And the guy comes on, and he says, well, they're taking fire out in the flats, and so they may have to turn around. I said, put me on frequency with them. So we gave the UHF frequency they were operating on from the boat. And I started talking to him. I got him to give me a holdout, which is a DS steer. I have a bearing pointer on my HSI in front of me, and it'll point to where they're talking from. So I get their heading over, they're heading from me, and I go directly to them. They're about 1,000 feet out over the flats, just south of them, which is a very heavily defended area. So all I can do is bring them back. They don't know where they're going. They're about ready to turn around. So I put down half lap, slowed to 250, and I did S turns in front of them about 1,000 feet. And to this day, I don't know why we didn't get shot at. But now I do, I think. They didn't expect us to be there. We told them we were going to be over here. So that really torques my tubes. Anyway, just below the surface is what we were trying to get them to not do, which is a cement bridge about a foot below the surface. Some of them went down there and took this picture later on, so I could put it up there for you. Here's one of the 135 guys rescued. Anyway, they were able to get the parachute, the harness down near him, so hoping he would strap on and be lifted up. They strapped down and said, he's not responding. I said, well, can you put somebody on the ground? They did. They put a pararescue on the ground. He drove, hooked him up. They took him in the helicopter, took him to the ship. He was beat up terribly. The kid that they put on the ground got the Navy Cross. I'm so proud of that. But you can see, this was back when everybody smoked. But 70% of people smoke in the sections. It's now down to like 15%. I was never old enough to smoke. My mother kept telling me. here's some of the battle damage. The 105 was just a great airplane. Like the B-17, it could take a great hit and keep flying. Here's a missile that actually went into the tail section. Here, one of their missiles actually went into the tail section, but didn't explode, so the airplane landed. Here's barely hanging on to the tail section. I tell you, as you're working toward the higher mission, we had hats that we put little hats with band, and we put little black marks on them. And every 5, every 10, you put another marker. And the term was, there ain't no way until you got around 90, and then you start saying, maybe there is a way. But you can see when your 100 mission is done, your squadron would have the names of the guys as you taxi up. And then here is my honest assessment. These are facts. I'm not, can y'all see that? It's kind of hard to read. But I want to get this point across, so I apologize for taking a little longer. But these are facts, and I'll argue with anybody to the day I die that these are not true facts. 14 December 72, Nixon got tired of Henry Kissinger and laid up going to Paris drinking tea and not doing anything. He told the North Vietnamese, begin talking seriously within 72 hours or else. Nothing happened. Nixon ordered Edelman order to Chairman JCS to prepare massive air attacks against targets near the Hanoi High Mall. Lifting restrictions, finally, they took those little circles away. And those little circles were there, and while they were there, you keep hearing these pundits say, well, the air war couldn't win the war. Well, listen for a few more seconds. Nixon said, this is your chance to use military power to win the war. Win, W-I-N. On 18 December 72, B-52 F-4 and 105G, the Wild Weasel aircraft, 3,000 sorties starting then, during the next 11 days, mainly over the heavily populated corridor that stretched 60 miles between Hanoi and Haiphong, the area that had been safe for them to run supplies in and out. I always said the safest place to be in North Vietnam during the air raid would be on top of a hotel in Hanoi, because nobody's flying that road there. At the end of this period, the North Vietnamese had no more sands in their arsenal, so they were just down to Tripoli. 27 January. Peace agreement signed by Kissinger and laid out to him in Paris. Peace agreement. End of the war. If you look at the newspapers back in the early February timeframe, you will realize that we had won the war as much as we could claim we won the war in Korea, which was the DMZ standoff. Both sides agreed to recognize the DMZ between the North and South. We had effectively exerted military force to extract peace terms. Nixon was being hailed for having won the war and getting our POWs returned after some 7, 8, some 9 years. I'll tell you, there's nobody that has more greater reverence from Nixon than a POW. Because somebody else might still be there. 4 June, Watergate scandal breaks. What did that do? Reduce Nixon's power. Fact. Democrat-controlled Congress. Fact. Enacts legislation barring U.S. funds from reporting South Vietnam. It's like Congress saying, well, we can't do anything to support the South Koreans. Well, what do you think? Democrat-controlled Congress. The North Vietnam read the newspaper, decided South Vietnam cannot stop them without this military aid. Well, they couldn't have done what they did without Chinese and Russian aid. So it wasn't like they were just a wonderful military power. Then in March of 75, North Vietnam advances across the DMZ and Ho Chi Minh Trail. 30 April, they took Saigon. My conclusion, take me to court if you think this is not true. We won the goddamn war and Congress gave it away. Those are facts. And I'll arm wrestle with anybody in the room who, after hearing this presentation, will say, we couldn't win the war. We won the war. It was won in February, March, and early April. Nixon was being hailed as having won the war. We forget that. And there's nobody who likes Nixon more than a POW. Here's an example. Here's one of Jim Terry was the Weasel pilot who was up there during this time. And here you can see some of the target stuff around Hanoi here. And they finally just raised their hand and said, oh, you really do plan to treat this like a war, Mr. Nixon. Here's the guys going home when some of the 141s are going out. Here's my buddy Jim Shepard right there. And you talk about some heavy campers. And that's my story, and I'm sticking to it.